Jesse, how are you? Good to see you. Why do you like Burke?
Well, I love Burke because he's a wonderful writer, he's an extraordinary political thinker, and he's a terrific campaigner against social injustice. In short, he kind of writes the textbook for what a really good MP should be.
He studies here, studies law, like lots of MPs, but he doesn't really like it.
No, he loves the law, but he's not keen at all on the Middle Temple, and he seems to have found it a very narrow, dry education. And he's got a lovely simile here, where he says, "He that lives in a college after his mind is sufficiently stocked with learning is like a man who, having built, rigged and victualled a ship, should lock her up in a dry dock." And I think he felt locked up in a dry dock himself while he was in the Middle Temple.
His most recent biographer has argued he became the godfather of modern conservatism.
Burke is the first person to gather together into a coherent body of thought ideas that we would now consider properly conservative, long before there was ever a conservative party in existence. And those ideas include respect for tradition, a feeling that political action must be cautious and reforming rather than radical and revolutionary. And therefore, the one thing he is resolutely opposed to is any kind of rationalism that would sweep away institutions that already exist and which have proved their worth in history.
Why have you brought me here?
Well, Dr. Johnson and Burke are two of the great big beasts of 18th century London, and I thought we should see Dr. Johnson's house to get a sense of what it was really like. Well, Johnson is Burke's ticket to the centre of literary London, and it's an amazing moment where Britain is kind of exploding with talent and thought. You've got Adam Smith revolutionising economics, you've got David Hume in philosophy, you've got Johnson himself in every branch of literature, and then Burke is determined to leave his own imprint on politics.
So what does he come up with?
Well, he comes up with the first theory of representative government and of party politics and of the duties of an MP. And what's extraordinary is he doesn't just talk about it, he really puts it into practice himself. And there's a great moment where he says to his constituents, "Look, I'm not going to kiss your boots. What really matters is that I act on your behalf according to my best judgment and not simply on your instructions." And that's become the kind of great doctrine of the way an MP thinks today.
A lot of Burke is about framing into a coherent body of thought instincts that people already have. And I think the British in the end of the 18th century suspected that there was something rather extraordinary about this tiny island on the edge of Europe creating an entire global empire. And Burke was able to give them a way of thinking about their own history and their own institutions that then sustained this narrative for another, frankly, 200 years in many ways.
What's so fascinating about it, of course, is that Brooks is the home of the reformers, the Whigs. And Burke really believes in reform and not revolution. And the reason why he's in support of the American colonists is because he thinks their way of life needs to be preserved against crown imperial power. The reason he's against the French Revolution is because he thinks society is being overturned by a violent upheaval. And that's what he opposes so strongly. Well, it's really Burke who is driving the line between a state intervention we can't afford and cutting markets loose in a way that damages society. And so it's through Burke we understand social renewal. And without him, we really can't understand modern politics at all.
If it was there, then it must always have been there.
We're a little incautious about that, but we certainly like the fact that if it's been there for a while, then it has a wisdom that we generally respect. And I would argue very rightly so.